Okay, good afternoon or good morning, everyone, depending on when you watch this. This is a SETI Institute Mars 2020 special conversation. We have a new rover heading to the Red Planet. And fortunately, at the SETI Institute, we have a lot of Mars experts that we can talk about the rover, what it is in itself, where it's going, and what we're hoping will be discovered. So my name is Simon Steele. I'm the Director of Education and Outreach at the SETI Institute. And speaking with me today, we have three Martians, three Mars experts, Janice Bishop, Pablo Sobron, and Nathalie Cabrol, who is also the Director of the Carl Sagan Center here at the SETI Institute. So thank you everyone for joining me in this conversation. There's a lot of things to talk about. Let's talk about the rover. We're talking about where it's going and what we hope it will be discovering. Maybe it's good to start off with where it's actually heading. Nathalie, would you like to start and talk a little bit about why this particular destination was chosen for the rover?
So hopefully it's heading for Mars to start with. This is the target of the investigation, but more specifically, it's going to the Jezero crater. And Jezero is special. It's the kind of site that I have a special place in my heart for. It's a former lake at the surface of Mars in an impact crater. And the reason I have a special place for those type of sites is because when we started off trying to discover lakes on Mars, the Viking data was so poor that the only way to say that there was a hole in the ground where water could have pounded were impact crater lakes. So this is how we started the history of crater lakes on Mars. These were impact crater lakes, and Jezero is this type of site. So really amazing site. I think that it's going to be an exciting mission. You have all the ingredients for astrobiology. You have the environmental aspect for Jezero, because lakes are recording sediments, and those sediments with their chemistry, with their mineralogy, are going to tell us a lot about what kind of climate they were deposited under. You also have the aspect of the impact crater itself. When Jezero formed, you can imagine that this size of a crater is going to generate a lot of heat for a long time. So now you have a mixture of water and energy. And on top of all of this, you have this river coming into it, and little by little, those sediments are creating different type of environment. They are the memory of the environment that was there during the whole history of Jezero. And lakes, you know, they are wonderful places for life in general. And what I really like is that because they are creating an anoxic environment, which means that the sediments, when they are deposited, they are creating a place where there is no oxygen, and which means that if something was alive in Jezero, there is a good deal of chance that a fossil might be preserved, because this is typically a kind of environment that would do that. So very exciting place.
Yeah. Now, I'm sharing an image here of Jezero crater. Now, this isn't the real color. This is a colorized image to show the contrast of the different elevations of the crater. Nathalie, can you talk a little bit about some of the features on this?
Yes, absolutely. So what you see in the reds and yellow and a little bit of a greenish yellow are definitely the highlands around Jezero, and the rim, the higher part of the crater rim, still well preserved towards the bottom left of your screen. The blue, dark blue areas are the bottom of the crater. Obviously, it's not a deep hole anymore. It's still deep, but it's not as deep as it was when it was formed. What you are seeing now is more of a plain surface, which tells us that it has been filled by sediment. And some of these sediments, you see them on the left of your image, come from that river, from that channel that's entering and formed that delta. And you very well see still the shape of that delta. And in that delta, you also see some distributed channels and the front of the delta. So the shape is telling us about the dynamic. It's telling us about erosion. And what it's also recording is a history of deposition, erosion, climate changes. And this is a history book for us at very high resolution right there to tell us about the history of the region of Jezero. And there is the other channel on the other side. And so it's a very complex story that's going to be told here. And what I liked, just to finish here this description, is that Jezero cut in very, very old terrains that are almost 4 billion years old. But Jezero itself is 3.5 billion years old. So you have potentially 500 million years of history that we can collect by exploring Jezero. And the most interesting part, because this is the early history of Mars.
Okay. I'm gonna share another picture. And maybe Janice, you'd like to say a little bit more about this is a detail of the delta we can see here. And so what sort of rocks, if this was on Earth, what sort of things will we be looking for in this structure?
Well, the orbital data has told us a lot about the spectroscopy and the mineralogy, the composition of these sediments. And what's really cool is that these delta sediments, what you see in the middle there, these vary, the sediments downstream closer to where the lake was have a higher concentration of smectites, of clays, and the sediments that are uphill a little bit have a higher concentration of carbonates. And so one of the questions that I think the rover's going to try to address is, do we see differences in these sediments? Why do we see a change in mineralogy? Is it just due to a change in age? And another question that we're going to try to address is the origin of the carbonate. And like Nathalie said, the rocks here, some of them are really ancient. They're Nawakian rocks on Mars. And we haven't been to a site yet with a rover on Mars that has such old rocks. And the carbonates and these kind of smectites usually form in the ancient rocks. And then we want to find out, did the carbonate and the clays just kind of roll in? Did the river just kind of bring them in through the delta to the crater lake? Or were some of these reformed, dissolved, and then reprecipitated? And so that's something we're going to be looking to investigate with the rover.
Okay. Now this, as you say, this is looks like it's a river delta, but it's dry now, certainly on the surface. When was the last time water was flowing through this channel? What age are we talking about here?
Well, probably the initial clays and carbonate rocks formed about 4 billion years ago, or perhaps 3.7 billion years ago. And there was probably water in that area, maybe about that time, or maybe up to 3.5 billion years ago. I'm not sure that date is absolutely known. In many places on Mars, we see water we can see evidence of water in crater lakes, but we don't know when they were full and when that might have trickled off. So there could have been transient water for some time where the lake may have filled up and then poured out, drained out. But certainly the last 3 billion years, it's been dry. So 3 billion years is a long time. But what's interesting is the time that water was there is about 3.5 to 4 billion years ago, which is about the time that life evolved on Earth. Mm-hmm. And these sediments containing smectite clays and carbonates should be able to preserve biosignatures, as Nathalie was saying before. So, and a lot of people think that these smectite clays on Earth might have been present while life was forming on Earth. So an environment like Jezero Crater that has these kinds of smectite clays could be perhaps able to preserve a biosignature if life was present there.
Okay, so if this was a riverbed on Earth this long ago, we'd perhaps be seeing the first evidence of life in these flows. And if the same thing happened on Mars, maybe again, you're looking at a possibly similar thing happening there. That's really cool.
That's right. And one thing when we're looking at the rocks on Mars to try to find evidence of the geologic history, it's a little bit easier than on Earth, because on Earth we have plants growing, we have roads and we have buildings. We have a lot of chaos due to the abundant life on our planet. And because Mars is a lot simpler, and there's been a lot less action in the last 3 billion years, it's a lot easier to see the geologic history. So trying to look for that on Mars could be easier than trying to look for that on Earth.
And it's also better preserved because the erosion rate, although it was greater at the very beginning of the history, still lesser than on Earth, and you don't have the plate tectonics that's recycling rocks. So this is also why it is so critical for us to go to old sites, because if life took hold on Mars, the record of it might be waiting for us, and that would be a way for us to try and understand the very early stages of life somewhere, something that is really difficult to do on Earth.
Mm-hmm. So in early 2021, there will be something new to look at in Jezero Crater, and that's the Perseverance rover. Pablo, tell us a little bit about this rover. Now, it's similar in size, we've heard, to Curiosity. It's about the size of an SUV that's going to touch down. But obviously, a lot of technology has changed since then, and it has new mission goals, doesn't it? I'm going to bring up an image of the rover itself, and maybe you could talk through some of the key features of Perseverance.
Of course. As you say, Simon, well, I guess zoom out a little bit the picture. I don't know. I'm seeing it a little bit zooming. I don't know about the others, but one thing to remember here, and I think something that we all should keep in mind is that the science community about 10, 15 years ago came to the conclusion. Oh, there it is. Okay, that's beautiful. So the science community came to the conclusion that in order to really assess whether there is or not, or there was or not, life on Mars, probably the best chance we have is to bring a sample back to Earth, where we have the best labs and the best scientists to work on those samples. The goals of Perseverance are not to look for life, but to find the best set of samples that when collected and preserved and brought back to Earth can give us the best overview and the best picture of what Mars was and is today, and whether it contains any traces of former or present life. So that's the context of the mission. That's what we want to accomplish. And to be able to select those very best samples, the very first step is to find the landing site, right? So like Nathalie and Janice described, there was a long process in which scientists argued and discussed and came to the conclusion that Jezero had the best shot at containing those high value samples that one day will bring back to Earth. So I think about this rover as the very first step in this long, probably decade plus long quest for bringing samples back to Earth. The instruments that were selected to accomplish this selection and collection of samples, and you have them here in the picture, and they all have very, very interesting names, and I'm not going to go and describe all of them because you have information online. But to give you an idea, what you want in a rover of this class is you want a very powerful vision. You want eyes that can see far ahead of you, so you can make decisions about where you want to go and how fast, and whether you want to actually go there, or you just are happy enough to use your vision, right? Your remote sensing vision to scout out outcrops or other formations that are interesting for you. So the eyes of the rover, for the first time, we have a color adjustable zoom teleobjectives, almost, if you want, that can do a stereoscopic imaging of a scene on Mars. So for the first time, we're gonna be able to see a rock with depth perception and in full color. And I think this is one of the highlights of the mission, is that it's gonna give us a very clear picture of what's ahead of us and in front of the rover. And
that's the NASA NAV that's shown in the middle there.
Exactly, that's what's called the zoomable panoramic cameras. To add to that vision, there is some sort of like Superman or superhero type of vision there, which is what we call SuperCam. And with SuperCam, not only we can see what your eyes see in the visible and a little bit, you know, into the ultraviolet and into the infrared, which is beyond what we can see with our human eyes. SuperCam can not only do that, but can also shoot the laser up to 7 meters away and do two things with the laser. One is scan the sample in a very, very careful way. Careful in the sense that we're able to select two different modes. One is whether we want to really, really understand the surface, the pristine composition of the sample with a very faint laser, and we get information. And sometimes we actually want to clean up the surface, and we want to brush off some of the dust or some of the weathering that is there. So we can crank up the power of the laser. We can actually remove and clean off, shave off some pieces of the rock, and take a look at what's behind of these rocks that Natalie and Janice were saying that have been very well preserved. That is very true, but over hundreds of millions of years, if not billions of years, of dust blowing off and of radiation and CO2 oxidizing the sample, most of them, they develop this crust and this coating of orange and red, which is what you see on a telescope on Mars. That's why it's all red. It's been oxidized to a point that everything looks red. So sometimes you want to actually dig a little deeper right into that, and you want to see what's behind. So we can do this with this SuperCam laser. And for the very first time to hear, lower first here, there is a microphone attached to this instrument. So we can actually see the noise, or can actually hear the noise that we're making with this laser as we are digging into the sample. And this will be audios and videos, actually, that will be released to the public. So for the first time, we can hear the science on Mars as it's being done. And once all this big picture, far ahead, far away instruments decide that there is a particular interesting place to go and do science and potentially get a sample, that's when Sherlock and Pixel, those two instruments that you see, they're mounted on the hand, the arm on the far end. Those two instruments are able to really take a microscopic view of what those samples are made of, and they're doing that by using LEDs and lasers as well. But instead of looking at the big picture, like our telescopes, they're gonna be able to see at the micron scale, seeing those features that that life may or may not have imprinted on those samples, those things that we call biosignatures or biomarkers, which are they're nothing different than just basically a fingerprint of what life was or is, and something that we can see on the rock record today. So fast forward a little bit, and once we're happy with what we see with those things, by the way, I'm talking about a month-long campaign at this point here. With these things happen very, very slow on Mars. And once we're very happy and the science community decides that, hey, this place is really, really potentially interesting, then is when the drill, which is also mounted on the arm, on the back end of Sherlock and Pixel, is gonna be able to capture cores that are going to be something like an ice cream, basically. It's like a 5 or 6 inches long by 1 inch wide cylinder. And it's going to be able to capture, I think it's up to 30 of those, if everything was okay, with a few blanks for safety. But a couple dozen of those rocks that will be collected over the Martian year, or 2 Martian years, rather, if the mission is healthy. And those are the samples that one day will be brought back to Earth.
We'll talk a little bit more about the exciting concept of sample return in a little bit, which is what the rover's going to do. But you mentioned biosignatures. The rover is not actually searching for life itself necessarily. It's searching for the markers for life. Natalie, what Give us an example of some biosignatures.
You can have many type of biosignatures. You can have chemical biosignatures. You can have physical biosignatures. When you know, the most common people are familiar with would be a fossil. A fossil would be the best thing ever to find. So then you have to think in terms of what is the oldest fossil that we found on Earth. These are stromatolites. These are the remnants of blue and green algae, which are about as old as the age of the Chesuro crater. That makes it interesting. And the only reason I mentioned that is not that I necessarily think that we could find the same thing exactly on Mars as we found on Earth, but there is room to think that, you know, cyanobacteria, blue and green algae are really, really easy to form, and we have the same kind of ingredients on Mars and the Earth. So it might not be exactly green and blue algae, but maybe something looking fairly similar that we can recognize. And that's the thing, you know, how do you recognize life? And then there are organic signatures. We already know that we have plenty of organics on Mars. So it's not going to be a discovery if we find more organics. Organics are the bricks of life. What is more interesting is just, they are just like Legos, Lego bricks. Did they assemble into something that actually we can recognize as life? And so on and so forth. So this is what we talk when we say when we talk about biosignature. There can be a range of it. I'd like to go back a little bit to what Pablo was saying in terms of searching for the best rocks and caching the best rocks. And one of the concern that I had at the very beginning when the mission was presented was that how do you reconcile a rover that is very powerful and then that's built really to cover ground and give you the best chance of assessing a number of different mineralogy and cover as many, many miles as possible with the work that basically is one that you would do following, you know, microbial ecology, statistical surveys, or, you know, unless you really want to go and look for those good rocks and looking by chance, finding the right one. I don't think that anybody wants to do that. And I was really happy to see that one way of going about that question is reconciling the big rover capability with some strategy of making a pass, doing a reconnaissance to some site, and then go back to some places and do some more fine works. It's still not the work of a microbial ecologist in an extreme environment that is going to sit in place for many, 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 many days at one place and then move on. We cannot do that. We cannot afford to do that on Mars. But still, it's something that is going to be really helpful.
Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of compromises, you say, that have to go
Absolutely.
Into the design.
You have to. In a mission like that, it's always about compromise, about getting the best science, reaching our goals, and getting people with these instruments on board the time to achieve their goals, because their goals is the goal of a mission. So, always about compromises.
So, and then, Nathalie, I think you bring a key point on this, and your concern was, I'm speaking on behalf of myself and my team when I say this, but I believe NASA understood that. And they added on a helicopter as part of the payload for this mission. And, and you know, not to kind of lower down expectations, but flying on Mars is very difficult. If any of the audience has ever flown a drone high up in the mountains, you start seeing the performance. It's a little bit more challenging, right? And that's exactly what Simon is showing here now. To be able to create lift and motion, you need to have atmosphere, which Mars only has about 1% of what we have on Earth here. So there is a lot of technological challenges that went into designing and building a helicopter that will be able to fly on Mars. So we're taking this helicopter instrument as a technology demonstration, okay? So it's not gonna do any science per se. All it has as a payload, if you think about it in scale, the drone that you can buy commercially today for about, you know, a couple hundred dollars, it has a camera that is about 20, 30 grams in mass, and basically half the size of your cell phone in mass. You can fly probably about half an hour on Earth with such a camera and such a drone. Now, trying to fly a helicopter on Mars with the same camera, it's only gonna get you about 2 minutes far into ahead from where you are, right? So you need to use all the energy you can to spin as fast as you can to be able to move on that thin atmosphere. So that's never been done before on Mars. Mm-hmm. This is the very first technology milestone for us to eventually be able to get better at building these helicopters so they can carry the instruments that Nathalie was referring to. Instruments that can eventually cover a lot of more ground much faster to be able to do survey style studies that can actually complement what boots on the ground, in this case wheels on the ground, are doing for the search for life.
But I still think that, you know, NASA listened to the microbiology aspect of the mission as well by just changing their strategy instead of, you know, going linearly from point A to point B. Being able to come back, it was already a plus. For the helicopter, there is this type of reconnaissance that we can do, and you and Janice and I, we know very well for having tried this in the field with your drones and others. There is also this incredible capabilities that those drones will have to help us integrate the information we have from orbit to the ground, from, you know, what the rover is doing, from what we're seeing in orbit, and having the missile resolution from the helicopter is going to help us actually expand our view of what's around us by understanding what signature correspond to that. And all of a sudden you are able to map a lot faster and choose your targets a lot faster. So I think that there are elements that are absolutely fascinating to this mission. It's a great first in our, you know, our search for life on Mars. And it's it already has the ingredient of what I see could be future mission with a lot more capabilities, etc. But right there, it's going to be absolutely fascinating.
I wanted to add a little bit more to what Nathalie just said about the helicopter and the view that we're going to get from above. And the instruments on the rover itself are going to be able to measure the mineralogy and the chemistry and the composition of the rocks at really a micro scale and at a, you know, sort of meter scale for the nearby things. And then the helicopter, the images from the helicopter will be able to look at those different outcrops that were characterized in detail by the rover, and then look around the rover and see, you know, which things look like those rocks that we just characterized. And it'll really help us coordinate the ground truth from the rover to the vicinity of the rover, and then to the orbital data that we're also collecting with Prism and HiRISE. So I think having that helicopter view will really help coordinate the rover data with the orbital data that's more comprehensive and global across the whole planet.
So you're looking at things at three different scales now, which is very, very good. The micro scale, and then the sort of the local topological scale, and then from the orbiters you get a much more global image of what's going on.
And we have to do that on Mars because we cannot have boots on the ground yet, and you know, it's not follow the water anymore. It's more follow the data. You know, try to figure out what we see, what we can actually track down from orbit to the ground. And although the helicopter is a technology demonstration, I can foresee, and Pablo as well, for you know, all the drones that you have been piloting all these years, there is an enormous potential, provided we learn how to you know, keep those helicopters safe and flying safe on Mars. It's an amazing tool.
And for those of you who really, you know, don't care much about what the sample are made of, but care about, you know, the good views of Mars, one of the key missions for the helicopter is going to be to take a panoramic or a orbital video of the rover, mm-hmm, from a bird's eye of a drone. So I suspect that's going to be one of the key highlights when it comes to visual impact of what this mission is gonna give back to the community. This for the first time we're gonna be able to see a rover in action, mm-hmm, not from the selfie cameras, but from far above, from the bird's eye. So I think that's equally fascinating when you think about the technology that goes into bringing a rover to Mars and a helicopter that is able to take a video of that rover working on Mars. I think it's absolutely mind-blowing.
Yeah, because it's a brand new perspective, isn't it? As you say, we've got the orbital shots looking straight down, and you've got the rover from the sort of ground level, but now this is a brand new perspective on the planet. It'll be remarkable to see.
And I'm sure that'll help with troubleshooting too. It seems like it always happens that something gets stuck or stops working properly, and the engineers are busy trying to figure out what happened. And if we can just get that view from the top, looking down, oh, okay, well, this is what's stuck, then I think that'll help diagnose the problem and get through it faster than we've had the opportunity in the past.
Yep.
So that's one of the new things that obviously Perseverance has. It has its own pet helicopter, which is amazing. But something else that this rover is going to do the previous rovers haven't, and that's the concept of not only sampling the rocks, but collecting samples. Pablo, say a little bit more about what this rover is. In fact, it's not an endpoint in itself. It's actually a start point, isn't it, for exploration?
Yeah, absolutely, Simon. And just to clarify, so NASA has been collecting samples with all the rovers we've sent so far, most of the rovers. The difference now is that for the very first time, we're going to be able to drill deep enough into the subsurface, again, 5-6 inches, if everything goes okay. And we're going to be able to extract a core that is intact, right? So in the past, we've been able to, like Curiosity, as we speak, is drilling on Mars and is getting powder out that is being picked up with a scoop, and it's being passed into the belly of the rover, and it's being analyzed by a laboratory that is inside. Now, for the very first time, we have a rover that has no lab inside, because the goal here is to spend all the time and resources we have to get that sample intact, the sample that preserves the depth structure of the sample with all the textures, all the mineral veins, all the layering that may be there, all the hotspots surrounding by what makes them a hotspot, that habitability concept that Natalie was alluding to earlier. So this is the key innovation here, is to be able to get a core intact. And before it has a chance to react with the atmosphere, remember the atmosphere is almost vacuum and it's very oxidizing. So the samples will transform very quickly when you take them out of the ground. So what we built with the system is a new way to encapsulate hermetically the cores as they're coming out, so that they're sealed. I think they rated them for about 25 years, guaranteed a perfect sealing. So use before, that's the guarantee that JPL is building into this. So that's the really great innovation here. And like Natalie, Janice, and a lot of our scientists at SETI and elsewhere, I will tell you, is it is very important to understand a sample within its context, right? And powder is not going to cut it if we are able to, or we want to be able to assess past life or present life on Mars. We need that traces of life with their context around it. So that's the reason why we are caching those samples and eventually bringing them back, because that's the next frontier into looking for life.
And this is why Jezero is such a great site for it, because you see all of these sediments layered. So right there you have boundaries, temporal and spatial boundaries that are right there. The idea is just not to pick up a float somewhere, you know, like just a rock. You might want to do that for contingency science, because at this point in time, I think that any rock from Mars is going to be some piece of knowledge that is interesting. But in terms of the goals of the mission, you want a site like Jezero, because you have temporal boundaries. In that stratigraphy, you can replay, you can position your site, your sample, and understand in what type of environment it evolved in, it was deposited in, and then was modified by. So these are very important keys for scientists.
And this coring idea and looking for the stratigraphy or the horizons below the surface, is similar to what we do in Antarctica in the dry valleys, where the surface is really dry, like on Mars, not quite as dry as Mars, but it's very dry, and the surface is covered with sort of gravel and dust and sand. But if you go down just a few centimeters, a couple inches, then we see moist samples that contain salts and clays, and it looks like they're bits that are partly permafrost or partly frozen during part of the year, but then during the warmer seasons, there could be small amounts of liquid water flowing through there and collecting these salts and collecting clays. So it'd be really interesting to look on Mars and see if we see a similar kind of transition from the really dry, desiccated material that's been really dried out and beaten to death by the wind on the surface, and then down below a little bit, a couple of inches, maybe we'll see some evidence of a more active chemistry and some aqueous processes, perhaps not today, but before the water completely was removed on Mars.
Well, so I wouldn't discount that, you know, at all for today. I remember us exploring CUSEF, and although the first 6 months were quite boring because we had to go through that lava plain, one of the interesting discovery was the realization that there was still today some interaction between the surface and the atmosphere. And we had this cementation that was happening at the grain size, which means that there was a little bit of fog or a little bit of condensation happening, and that was enough to create that cement. You were talking about some salt that were deposited here. So things are still happening slowly, but they are, and they have a role to play in the way that the texture of the sediment is going to change, how it is going to affect how the rest underneath it is going to be transformed or modified. So I am expecting we are going to see some interesting processes. They might not be spectacular as the flow of that river and the delta forming here, but things are still changing day to day on Mars and season to season.
And we've never looked at the assemblages below the surface in the same kind of way. So it'll be something totally new that we're able to see with this rover.
And actually, to that end, one of the instruments that you saw in the picture earlier, it's called WinFax. So WinFax is a radar that is looking down into the ground. So think about radars when they're airplanes, they're looking everywhere. This one is just looking straight down with the goal to be able to find these environments that may have water or other different materials. We're looking at transitions, right? Or to see what happened in the past, because now it's all buried by dust. So it's very interesting for us to have the third dimension as well. And for the first time, we'll be able to have a two-dimensional view of the surface with the rover, a little bit scratching the surface with the drill, a few inches. But the real differentiating factor here as well is that we can see hundreds of meters below, at least tens of meters below, depends on the material, with this radar. So we'll be able to see geophysical formations that are different as the rover is moving around on the depth dimension. Another key novelty here as well.
Mm-hmm. And as you say, these samples, they are hermetically sealed, they're you know, protected, and they have to be protected, of course, from the rover itself. NASA considers the concept of planet protection, cross-contamination of worlds as absolutely vital here. Because what you want to have in this sample is a sample of Martian biosignatures and not a sample of biosignatures from Florida. So say a little bit more about what NASA does in order, first of all, to protect Mars from you know, contamination from Earth. And then, of course, we're bringing the samples back, aren't we? And the issue of bringing potentially biomaterials back to the Earth.
I think that's a question more for Nathalie or Janice than for myself, but I will just, I'll just give the high level and then you can correct me if I'm wrong. But as you say, Simon, you're 100% correct that NASA is, and all the agencies in the world, for that matter, we take that premise very seriously, and we don't want to bring any biology out there. Unfortunately, there is no way to guarantee that you're going to be 100% clean. But what we do within NASA is go through a very, very thorough and very clear protocol to sterilize the rover. Not the whole rover is not sterilized equally. Reason is that some parts, they're very sensitive, and to sterilize, you can do things like bake parts for days at a time at 400 degrees or more. You can swipe with alcohols or with vapor, dry heat, like you're doing a dry cleaner. You can do very nasty things that you don't want to do to most things. But for the parts that are going to be in contact with the sample, like the drill and the caching system, that has gone through a very, very painful, I'm going to say, for the teams doing that, cleaning procedures that guarantee that we're doing the best we can to not bring any bacteria to Mars. Because you're totally right, the last thing you want to do is to find life on Mars, only to discover that it's the life that you brought from Earth. And vice versa, you don't want to bring life to Earth that it may be harmful for us as here, right? So I think philosophically, it's something that it's built into the design of the mission itself. Really care about this a lot. But I think Nathalie has more information.
I just wanted to add that none of us here are planetary protection experts, but we all have been in our near or in Mars mission. So I think that one of the aspects of planetary protection is a count of bacteria per unit surface. So you have to be at that level or below to be considered sterilized enough. Now, another thing that plays into the planetary protection aspects of things is that then once you are at the surface of Mars and your rover is sitting there, Mars is a fairly sterilizing environment. You have short UVC, short UV, including UVB and UVC, falling at the surface. This is not going to help any DNA anywhere. This is, once the rover is exposed at the surface for enough days, I don't think there is a major risk at all. You know, life that is being transported there would have to be extremely well protected to survive only a few days on Mars. The risk that planetary protection is willing to avoid is as the rover comes and lands, we don't want it to be too close or in contact with water or with ice, because there might be immediate transfer of whatever could have been transported from Earth to that environment. And then that becomes a more friendly environment because life can be buried in that and have water. And we know of bugs on Earth that really thrive in extreme environment, not too different from Mars. So there is not such a risk at Jezero. There is no ice, there is no exposed water. And so after a few days on Mars, this rover is going to be very well sterilized. And for everything else, as Pablo mentioned, there are protocols and they are painstaking, but they are necessary. And as a scientist, I'm often frustrated, and we often say that, we wish we could go to some places. And right now we can't, because we don't feel that we have what it takes to make sure that we will be sterile enough upon arrival. But another goal of planetary experiment, and as sometimes it's misunderstood by the public or other scientists, is that planetary protection is not here to prevent you from doing science. It's here to make you understand, what is the kind of science that you want to do and where, and how we can help that process. So right now, the baseline is that if we wanted to land right next to the ice or where there is water, it would take a lot more, protocols and processes and maybe techniques we don't have yet. It's not that planetary protection doesn't want us to go there. It's just that we need to be safe. As far as Jezero is concerned, I am very confident that there is no risk there.
We're coming up to the end of our time, and I just wanted to finish by asking all of you, what would you like to see come out of this mission? And beyond that, how does this mission tie in with your vision of future searches for life, not only on Mars, but elsewhere in the universe. So we can flip a coin to start, but as Janice is at that particular square, we can start with you.
Sure, I'm really interested in investigating the carbonates. And for me, when we started the orbital spectroscopy searches a decade or so ago, we were expecting to see a lot of carbonates on the surface because the atmosphere is full of CO2, and we haven't. And so some of the questions are there carbonates below the surface, or did they get removed from some process? And so we'll be able to answer that a little bit, I think, with this mission. And also the carbonates that we see at Jezero, were these carbonates formed with the ancient clays in these ancient rocks as we think, or were they a subsequent aqueous modification? So were these clays formed in the ancient rocks and then some water came later and altered these, and then the carbonates formed then? So I think investigating the carbonates and the clays together at Jezero is going to really help us understand this picture, and that'll help us then with the other carbonate sites we see to understand when these carbonates were formed along the history of Mars. And the carbonates are such an indicator for life that might help us understand the timeline a little better, not just at Jezero crater, but at other places on the planet where we see carbonates and clays. So that's what I'm hoping that we're going to find out.
Okay. Now, Pablo, you are invested in one of the instruments on the rover. So what are you hoping to get out of that in particular and in the rover in general?
So I want to get two things out of this. And I'm going to start with the one that you mentioned. So this is the very first time that we have a technique that is called Raman laser spectroscopy. And it's one of the techniques that is recent, is new, and it's taking north decades to mature enough that it's going to be shooting on Mars and looking at things on Mars. So what I want to get out of this is validation that this technique can actually be useful for looking for life on Mars. But more broadly, I think what I would like out of this mission is that I want to see this kickstarting a really truly international effort towards exploring the universe, or let's talk more modestly, exploring the solar system in a more coordinated way. And the reason why I'm hopeful about this is you may be aware that last week, the Emirates and China successfully launched two missions that are on the way to Mars right now. European Space Agency will launch its own rover in 2 years' time. So you have four different agencies that are launching their own space program to Mars with different objectives, very complementary. And there's been a lot of post-talk in between agencies. But I think space beyond the International Space Station, space exploration is a potential playground where we can experiment with all kinds of cross-collaboration between countries, agencies, scientists, and technological transfer between different partners out there. So it's my hope that this really, really gets the eye of the public globally, in that there's a lot of people that want to understand Mars with the same goal: is there life on Mars or not? So I think this is a golden era for that, and I'm hoping that all these missions will bring us together in that sense.
Okay, that's really cool. Nathalie, where is this taking us?
Yeah, I you know, heartfully agree with Pablo. I think from a more philosophical standpoint, this is humanity's exploration. It's not what country's exploration. And as you said, you know, there are four agencies going after Mars. I think that, yes, they have different objectives, but let's think about putting our resources together, and maybe we can have, you know, a coordinated program and all of us, instead of spending money to do about the same thing and just for the sake of national prestige, going after one thing for ourselves. It's especially important when you think of this as maybe the prelude for colonization of Mars, where you know, that's supposed to happen in the next decade. So I would like to see this. But in terms of the science itself and where it's taking us, of course, you know, what you would like to see is that I was talking about luck, etc. just where is the right place to be looking for. There are a number of sites where biosignature might have been actually preserved if life ever appeared on Mars. So my hope is that we can find something that makes us think. Do we have really a way to say that we will be finding life or we have found biosignature, et cetera, without bringing that rock to the Earth? I don't know about that, but I'd be really satisfied if we already have something that's really make us scratch our head. The second point is that I do believe that Mars, you know, and you were talking about all the other places. Yes, the ocean worlds are amazingly interesting and I'm fascinated by them. And it's free sample, et cetera. You know, they are here, they are shooting geyser stuff into space. But there is something special about Mars. Mars is very close to us. We have exchanged material with Mars. And it may be that just maybe we have the same genesis. And if it's true, then somewhere in an outcrop on Mars, there might be the answer to who we are and how it all started, that's sitting there waiting for us to be there and to collect it. And this is something that is unlikely to happen on Earth just because of plate tectonics, right? So this is the exciting part. And of course, there is the possibility that we won't have any answer at this point in time with JSRO. But because we are scientists, it's not a sign, you know, that we are failing. It's just a sign that we need to refine our questions. And so that will be progress anyways. And whether Mars, if it had life, had the same genesis, so a shared genesis or a different genesis, or this is one of my secret, you know, I'm not sure it's a nightmare or a dream or a fantasy, but an hybrid kind of life. So that, you know, life started on both planets differently, but we had some material exchange and then something happened where both of those were able to co-evolve. Whatever it is, we are going to learn something about, you know, environments for life on two different planets that were quite similar, but not quite the same at the same time. And also potentially about maybe the origin of life, the processes that make life happen. So Mars is a cool, very cool place, literally and figuratively. And this is our playground to understand how things are getting started, because we don't have a surface really we can explore on the ocean world. We will have to dig samples, etc. But there are nothing as close as Earth as Mars is. So definitely a special place and a special mission.
Yeah. And a little bit of light in the darkness in this current times as well.
That too, I think that we sometimes we have a little bit much too much life, or, you know, co-evolution of life and environment here on our planet. So Percy is wearing her mask. She is sterilized and she's virus free, and we are not exporting COVID on Mars at all. I've seen so many horrible headlines these past few days, a lot of misinformation of all sorts. She's going in for a wonderful exploration for all of humanity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point to leave it. Thank you, Pablo, Janice, and Nathalie for this conversation. Obviously, this is just the start of the exploration, and please do continue to check in with the SETI Institute. We're going to have more conversations, more discoveries, and who knows where this will lead. Thank you very much, everyone, and goodbye.
Thank you, Simon.
Thank you.